I guess you guys have kind of decided on that to be a permanent home, at least for now. What Melbourne is the decision of making it, of staying with Asheville this year?
You know, Moog Fest for us, it's kind of feel like that this is where it should be. You know, Moog Music, it's Moog, that's the home of
right.
Moog Music. It's the last 30 years of Bob's life was spent in Asheville, North Carolina. The Moog Foundation, nonprofit arm, is based in Asheville. And if you've never been to Asheville, it's one of the most halcyon settings in the country. It's, the downtown is absolutely gorgeous. You're nestled right there in the mountains. Some of the best food, local artisans, all gathered in a walkable downtown. And to be honest, I couldn't pick a better place.
Sure. And that's kind of one of the things that I was going to lead into with it being the indoor event that it is, kind of sparsely scattered amongst those downtown venues there. One of the things that last year, and I don't know if you guys, there's anything y'all can even do to help limit some of that, but a lot of people had tried to get into some of the smaller venues and it had some problems. What do you recommend for people if they're wanting to get into, say, the show that's going on at the Orange Peel as opposed to, you know, what might be going on at the Civic Center or at Thomas Wolfe?
You know, it definitely is a different, it's a different festival environment, and we do have those capacity issues at venues, and we try to strategically program the festival to where that stuff won't happen, to where, you know, people who if you want to see something, you're going to have the ability to get in there if you bought a ticket. But obviously with some smaller venues, tough decisions do have to be made, and if there's something you can't miss and it happens to be at a smaller venue, you know, we recommend you get in there a little bit early.
Yeah, that's just one of those things.
Yeah, and it's, you know, we try to make, you know, we're not going to put the Flaming Lips, you know, at the Orange Peel. You know, we realize
right.
that that's a headliner act, and we need space for that to accommodate everybody who's going to, you know, plans to attend that show. And so that, you know, that's our goal. And when I say strategically planned, you know, we are well aware of those issues and doing everything humanly possible to make sure that that type of stuff's going to happen, because it's really about the experience for us, and we want to make sure that our fans are having the best possible festival experience known to man with as little strife as possible.
And it is a good experience. It was a lot of fun last year. I mean, even if somebody just cycled between Thomas Wolfe and the Civic Center event, it was, you know, I mean, it was still lots of music going on all the time.
Right.
A lot of stuff went on into the wee hours of the morning. And some of the,
yes, it did.
Other sites. But, you know, speaking of the Flaming Lips and some of the artists that you guys have got this year, I guess really kind of one question that I had was, you know, how much thought went into, you know, for example, I mean, it's called Moog Fest, so you've got, you know, obviously the equipment that goes in. I guess my question is, when you're getting these artists together, is it, I mean, you know, this might sound dumb, but is it a requisite that they use that equipment? Not that that's a very tall requisite, since I think every band in the world has something
right.
on their stage from that.
It's funny. No, it is not a requisite. You know, Bob Moog, I think one of the legacies that he left behind is pushing the limits. And not settling for what's out there. And legacies are leaving behind is don't accept it. Keep pushing. And Bob was a tinkerer. I mean, he was you know, he was the guy taking a speak and speller, any electronic instrument, and making sounds. And what the vision really of the festival is embracing that and saying, kind of paying homage to some of the old. I mean, you got, you know, God, Flaming Lips have been around for a little while now, but Tangerine Dream, Suicide,
yeah.
You know, some of these guys that have just laid the foundation and really paved the way for these new soundscapes and just engulfing instrument noise and everything that we have there. And then who is doing it new? You know, who are the new innovators? You know, like the Neon Indians, oh, gosh, I mean, Amon Tobin, you know, obviously the list could go on and on there, but who are these new guys that are breaking new ground, that are developing new things, that are pushing the limits and boundaries of sound entertainment and, you know, the visual auditory experience that we know for a live show? And that's really the requisite for Moog. It's not necessarily do you have to play Moog. You know, it's good if you do, but – it's not a requirement by any means. It's who is pushing the limits of what we know today and putting on, you know, what can be regarded as one of the best live shows that you'll ever see. And I think that's the beauty of Moogfest, is it's gathering all of these visionaries, young, old, seasoned, together in one place and putting a festival on with them.
And how did AC become involved? What was the meeting of the minds like when you got with, I guess, the Moog Foundation, and you guys kind of partnered up and joined hands and said, all right, we're going to have a festival and we're going to call it Moogfest?
For us, it's our second year being involved.
Okay, all right, gotcha.
Yeah, and Moog Music had this festival in New York, and
right.
I think they felt it was a disconnect. It wasn't true to the roots. You know, a lot of it was, paying homage to a lot of the original innovators, but it wasn't catching on, I think, the way they wanted it to. It was a one-day thing, you know, in one room, and
mm-hmm.
When they approached us about it, you know, we're in love with Moog, and we're in love with Moog Music and the foundation and what they're doing, as well as Bob himself. And for us, it's a passion project. I mean, you're kind of like a kid in a candy store. I mean, any music head is, especially like we are, sits back and says, you know, I get to be involved in this. I get to help program it. I get to do all these things and help bring it to life. And there already is so much meaning and passion attached to the Moog brand, and being able to have a festival that celebrates that, and the visionaries that are, you know, from the past, you know, the ones that are, you know, emerging as, you know, as we speak. I think that's what the fun part is kind of showing them, you know, they know instruments, you know, Moog Music knows instruments. We know festivals, and
yeah,
you talk about the
right.
combining of the minds right there. It's perfect. It's saying, okay, we're going to take your guys' knowledge and experience, and we're going to take that and show the world what it means.
Right.
And not put boundaries on it. I think that's the beautiful part too, is the only real boundary is the fact that, you know, it's a festival that's only happening 3 days.
Right. And I guess the last question I would have would be the fan experience. What have you guys done this year with fans in mind, in terms of, you know, when you start talking about some of these other events that AC's involved with, whether it's Spotteroo or any other events that you guys do, there's so many like interactive fan things. Is there anything like that we can look forward to this year for the fans?
Of course. And I think that's one of the places that we really wanted to step it up this year. You know, I think we laid the groundwork and definitely found lightning in a bottle last year. And this year it's just really about fine-tuning, tightening, and really expanding that experience. And for us, it really is. It's, you know, the not only auditory, but visual. I think we're really stepping up visual design this year and really trying to take it to what we're calling the fourth dimension. You got your visual design, your interactivity, being able to touch it, feel it, smell it. The whole, that is what we talk about when we speak of an experience. So, you know, involving people in the local community, you know, local businesses, because that's a part of it as well. Getting people to step foot in and have breakfast at Early Girl and walking in
right.
the Octopus Garden and some of these places that are downtown that are just fantastic. And looking at the local art, the street musicians that just happen to be out on a random Friday, all of that ties in together. And let's be honest too, we've got Halloween weekend. You know,
there you go.
You've got trick or treating and costumes and all of that stuff already right there, just kind of begging to be played with as well. So we're incorporating all of that into the festival this year and really making it adding to the rich auditory experience you're already going to, you know, have, is adding some, you know, additional visual element, really helping to challenge artists to say, okay, what are we going to do on stage? How are we going to make this just mind-blowing? And
mm-hmm.
that's where we're stepping it up this year, I think, is looking at those experiential things and saying, how can we have you interact? What can we have you see? How can we, you know, what can you touch? What can you play with? How can you be more immersed in this Moogfest experience? And that's what I think the exciting part for this year is going to be. For those that attended last year, they're going to be like, oh my gosh, I get to do this.
Right.
I get to do that.
And it's cool. I think you guys, with the choice of some of the bands, just off the top of my head, some of the bigger bands, with Flaming Lips, obviously a huge visual experience. Humphries McGee is a big visual experience
yep.
too. So
I'm on top.
Yeah, I mean, that's going to be really cool. So I'm definitely looking forward to it, Jeff, and I appreciate your time. I'm glad you were here. Yoshima.
She's a black belt in